يديه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد أيها المسلمون عباد الله, this afternoon we want to take a look at two very important, wonderful incidents that took place in the first year of the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Two events that took place in the first year after which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam emigrated from Mecca to Al-Madina. This before we start discussing the relationship between the Muslims and the Jews who inhabited Al-Madina. These two events about which we will be speaking are, one, the Adhan. How this Adhan, this call to prayer that we hear today, how it came about. And the second event will be the marriage of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Aisha radiallahu anha wa ardaha. As for the Adhan, then when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to Al-Madina, of course the Muslims had also emigrated before him from Mecca to Al-Madina. And with his coming, many other Muslims came as well. And people within Al-Madina had accepted Islam. Slowly but surely, Al-Madina became an Islamic state. The prayers were being offered openly, without any fear, and so on. And as far as gathering for the prayers was concerned, then the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to automatically come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the time of prayer. It was a great concern of theirs. So they were conscious of the time. And although there was no special call to the prayer except that they would be there on time, waiting for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to lead them in prayer. But one day they started discussing that perhaps it would be a good idea to have some sort of a call where the people could be invited to come to the prayer. And as they discussed, some of them presented the idea of using a bell, like the bell used by the Christians. And others said, but why don't we use a horn, like that which is used by the Jews? And at the end they didn't really settle for anything. Meanwhile, one of them, Abdullah ibn Zayd ibn Ta'labah, radiallahu anhu wa arda'ah, when he went to sleep, he saw a dream. And the next day he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and informed him. He said, last night, a man wearing two pieces of white clothing came to me, that is, in his dream. And he was holding a bell. So I asked him, will you not sell that bell to me? And that man asked me, and what is it that you want with this bell? He said, we will use it to call the Muslims to prayer. Subhanallah. The man was dreaming about this because this is the way of the mu'min, the believer. His primary concern is his religion. His primary concern is the deen. This is what he was concerned about. Now, the dreams that we have, Allah knows best what our dreams are all about. Those are the types of things we are concerned about. When you are concerned about something and you think about it so much, you are likely to dream about it as well. In any event, He says, the man then said to me, after I informed him that we want to use this to call the people, the Muslims, towards the prayer. This is all in his dream now. He says, the man said to me then, shall I not direct you to something which is better than that? He said, sure. And upon that the man said to him, قل, say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله. When he related this to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he responded to Abdullah ibn Zayd رضي الله عنه by saying to him that inshallah, by the will of Allah, this is a true dream. In other words, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم approved it. And for those who understand what the sunnah is, then the sunnah, we say, are the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whether they be things that we learn from his speech or through his actions or through his approval. This is from the category of the approvals, al-iqrar. He heard this from Abdullah ibn Zayd radiallahu anhu and he approved of it. Now listen what he says to Abdullah ibn Zayd. And there is a lesson that we are going to learn here, a lesson that we must live by as well. He says to Abdullah ibn Zayd radiallahu anhu arda, go to Bilal and teach him the words of this adhan so that he can call it because he has a better voice than you. I want you to picture this. You're the one who saw the dream. You come and say to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I learned these wonderful words to call the people to adhan. What would you be expecting? Deep down you would wish that it was you. Yes, he was going to appoint you because you're the one that had the dream. Yet he says, go to that person, not only that. He says, teach him the word so he can call the adhan because his voice is more suitable than yours. Many of us would have taken that as an insult. We'll come to that in just a few moments, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. So he went to Bilal ibn Rabah, radiallahu anhu, and he taught him the words of the adhan, and then Bilal, at the time of salah, he stood and he called out the adhan. He made that announcement. Upon hearing those words, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu wa arda quickly got out of his bed and he came running to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, I swear by the one who has sent you, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that I heard those very words last night as well. In other words, he had a similar dream. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam said, فَلِلَّهِ الْحَمْدُ عَلَى ذَلِكَ. And may Allah be praised for that. So Umar radiallahu anhu also had a similar dream. But of course, Abdullah ibn Zayd came first. Then we want to go back and learn that lesson from what took place between Abdullah ibn Zayd and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him to go and teach these words to Bilal, so that he could call the adhan because his voice was better, that is, it was more suited for the adhan. But Abdullah ibn Zayd radiallahu anhu was not offended. You see, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the intelligent amongst the people understand that for every task, for every duty, there are people who are suited for those tasks and duties. There is no such thing as al-mujamala. There's no flattery when it comes to important matters. You have to tell it like it is. You don't worry about whether somebody's going to be offended or not. If someone is suited for something, and now we're talking about important things. This was the adhan that was going to be called. And we'll see a few other examples as well, but even in our daily lives, running a society or an organization, if you are suited for a position, fine. If you are occupying a position and somebody more qualified than you is found, then you should not be offended if you are replaced by that individual. Here we see one example with Abdullah ibn Zayd and Bilal radiallahu anhu. He was not offended. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was so straightforward. He said, his voice is better than yours. For calling the adhan, his voice is more suited. Look also at what Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu arda did with Khalid ibn al-Walid and Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah radiallahu anhu was the commander-in-chief. He was the commander of the army in the region known as Asham, Syria and Palestine and the surrounding area. Then he receives this letter from Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, min Abi Bakr ila Abi Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah salamullahi alayk. He begins the letter from Abu Bakr to Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. May the peace of Allah be with you. فَإِنِّي قَدْ عَزَلْتُكَ. Wow. He says, I have removed you from your position as commander-in-chief of the army in the region of Asham. And I have replaced you with Khalid ibn al-Walid. And then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu continued in his letter to him, saying to him that I find that Khalid ibn al-Walid possesses some know-how. He has some skills pertaining to war that you do not possess. But you, O Abu Ubaidah, are better in my eyes than Khalid ibn al-Walid. Radiallahu ta'ala anil jamee. Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu was not offended in the least bit. But immediately upon receiving these orders from Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu arda, he accepted that demotion from being commander of chief to becoming a soldier who would be obedient to his new commander. And Khalid radiallahu anhu arda took that position with utmost humility. We have so many other examples as well. Look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He didn't appoint people because he liked them. He didn't appoint them because, you know, he didn't want to offend them. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu arda was not only his best friend but his father-in-law as well. But what happened in terms of the revelation when it came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Who was the first scribe? It was Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu, because he was suited for that position. When he needed to send someone to Al-Madinah to teach the people about Al-Islam before he would even emigrate there, did he choose someone who he was good friends with? Did he choose someone for the sake of choosing them because he would be in their good books? No, he chose Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu arda because he was best suited for that position. When he wanted to send someone to Al-Yemen to teach the people and invite them towards Islam, then he sent to them Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu arda because he was most suited for that position. So you and I have to learn this lesson. And it's sad to say, especially in the way that we run our Islamic societies and organizations, we vie for positions. We compete with one another even when we are not qualified. I understand all sorts of things about elections and so on and so forth, but the law of Allah Azza wa Jal, the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is what we follow. So when we look amongst ourselves to run our affairs, let us select those people who are suited for those positions. And if it is said to me that I am not suited for a particular position, of course, said to me by those who have understanding in these affairs, if it is said to you by someone who understands these affairs that you are not qualified, that you are not suited, but so and so is, then there should be no problem with us accepting that. We should not be offended. If I am not qualified, if I am not suited for that position, then alhamdulillah, let the one who is suited, let the one who is qualified, take and occupy that position. على كل حال. الأذان وما أدراكم ما الأذان. The أذان أيها الأحبة, literally by أذان what is meant is a call, an announcement. For us, when we talk about the adhan according to the sharia, this is a call to prayer. In other words, we call out with those words that I just relayed to you a short while ago, in order to inform the people that the time of salah has entered. This is the purpose of the adhan. To inform the people that the time of salah has entered. And calling the adhan in and of itself is a great act of worship, an act of ibadah through which one hopes to attain great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are a few things that we need to say about the adhan. Amongst them, how we should behave and how we should act when the adhan is being called. While the adhan is being called, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us what we should do. And it is for us to remain silent and listen to that adhan. And repeat after the muezzin. So once the muezzin calls out, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, then each of us to ourselves, we should also say those words, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, until the end of the adhan. Of course, we know after Hayya ala Salah and Hayya ala Falah, we say, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Once the muezzin completes the adhan, then we invoke peace and blessings on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then we say the dua, Allahumma rabba hadhihi da'wa ila akhir al-dua. The benefit of that is one who does so, then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will intercede on their behalf in the hereafter. Yet when the adhan is being called, this is the best time that we find to catch up on some gossip or news with one another, wal-iyadu billah. While the adhan is being called, we are busy talking to one another. We are busy exchanging notes and money and whatever else. This is not the proper etiquette with the adhan. While the adhan is being called, listen attentively. You are being called to the salah, but also listen to the words. It's a reminder to you of who you are. It's a reminder to you of what your deen, what your religion stands for. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Why have you left your workplace? Why have you left the comfort of your home to come to the masjid? Because Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allah is great. Allah is greater than all things. Allah is more important than all things. Ala kullin, even calling of the adhan, there are great virtues in that and merits. Let's look at maybe a few of the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from which we learn the importance of the adhan and also the merit of calling the adhan. From the merits of the adhan, the benefits and the virtues of the adhan, is what we learn from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that when the adhan is called, when the muezzin says, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, listen carefully, because after this, I want that every one of us make certain that the adhan is called in our homes. Men, call the adhan in your home. Have your children call the adhan in the home when the time of salah comes. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when the adhan is called, the shaytan, the devil, cannot tolerate it. The devil, the shaytan, cannot stand to hear the adhan. So he turns away. He leaves that place where the adhan is being called. And while doing so, he passes wind loudly to try and drown out the sound of the adhan. This is what we learn from the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then once the adhan and the iqama have been completed, so now the iqama as well, the same words are being repeated. The shaitan cannot stand to hear them, he goes away. Then once the salah, once the prayer is established, the shaitan comes back. And this is when he comes to you and starts reminding you of things that you forgot before the salah. Calling the adhan is a way of repelling, of chasing the devils from your home. So will you not call the adhan in your home? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also informed us from the merits or the virtues of calling the adhan. What he said to Abi Sa'sa'a radiallahu anhu, said to him, I see that you're a man who likes his sheep and you like to be out in the wilderness, you like to be out in the desert. So when you go out and you want to pray, then raise your voice with the adhan. For wallahi, no one or nothing hears that adhan, whether they be from the jinn or human being or anything else. When he says anything else, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam means the stones, he means the trees, he means everything. Everything that hears that adhan will then testify for you before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment. He also said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Allah is amazed by that man. A shepherd who goes to the top of a mountain and then he calls the adhan. And he establishes his prayer, he offers his prayer out of fear for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to his angels that look at this man. He has called the adhan and he's established his prayer out of fear for me. And he informs his angels then what he has done for that man, that he has forgiven him his sins. And he shall enter him into paradise. This is why people of understanding, they will compete with one another to see who can be at the masjid on time, that is, if there isn't an appointed muadzin. If there's a masjid and somebody's appointed, their task is to call the adhan, then of course I don't have the right to go and call the adhan before them, because this is a duty that has been given to them, they've been assigned to do so. But where, for example, there isn't a muadzin, you will find the people of understanding will compete with one another. This one wants to call the adhan and the other one wants to call the adhan. It's because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَوْ يَعْلَمُ النَّاسِ, if the people knew the reward in calling the adhan and in standing in the first row for salah, then those people, if they didn't have any other way to decide who was going to call the adhan, in other words, or who was going to stand in the first row, then they would even draw lots. Yet today we may offer someone, ya akhi, call the adhan, and if you know, it's okay. How can you walk away from forgiveness from Allah and entry into paradise? Today when we come to the masjid, the last rows are filled before the first. It is because we don't know the value of the first row. The Prophet ﷺ said, if you knew the value of it, then you would compete for it, and even if it meant that you had to draw lots, put your name in a cap, for example, and pick and choose to see who would get this is what you would do. So we don't do these things because we don't understand their value. In any event, we want to now look at that second incident that took place within the first year of the emigration to Al-Madinah. It is, as some people say, a very sensitive issue, but there's nothing sensitive about it. We will try to summarize it and make it as clear as possible. It is the marriage of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to our mother Aisha radiallahu anha wa ardaha. Aisha, the daughter of Abi Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu wa ardaha. Aisha radiallahu anha, who was from the most beloved of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to him. After Khadija radiallahu anha, he loved Aisha more than any of his wives. As a matter of fact, when he was asked, Ya Rasulullah, Man ahabbu nasi ilayk? O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who is the most beloved of people to you? He said, Aisha. Without hesitating, he said, Aisha, my wife. He said, no, I meant from the men. He said, Abu Bakr. He said, then who? He said, Umar radiallahu ta'ala anil jameer. Aisha radiallahu anha wa ardaha, who turned out then to be from the most knowledgeable and the greatest of scholars of Islam. Aisha radiallahu anha wa ardaha, who is one of those who reported the largest number of ahadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam contracted the marriage between him and her while still in Mecca, because 3 years before he emigrated, Khadija radiallahu anha wa ardaha had died. And he remained for a time, of course he married Sauda radiallahu anha, and then he remained for a while. When he went to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu warda and asked for his daughter's hand in marriage, the daughter of Abu Bakr being Aisha radiallahu anha. And Aisha radiallahu anha wa arbaaha was only 6 years old. Let me say it at the top of my lungs. Aisha radiallahu anha wa arbaaha was 6 years old when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam proposed marriage to her. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu wa arbaaha initially did not accept the proposal because he thought it was haram. He thought it was unlawful because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةً, that the believers are no more than brothers to one another. So he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is she lawful for you because you are my brother? And in response, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yes, you are my brother in faith. You are my brother in Islam. We are not biological brothers. So yes, she is lawful for me. Then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu warda, the proposal was made. He accepted that proposal on behalf of his daughter Aisha radiallahu anha warda, and she remained in her parents' home. Then after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to Al-Madinah, and she was 9 years old, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam consummated the marriage. She now came to live with him, and they lived as a husband and wife would do. Didn't I tell you that some of them consider this to be a sensitive topic? Granted, some of the scholars of history said that she was 16, she was not 6, and they tried to bring about, you know, certain proofs. But the vast majority of the scholars are agreed that she was 6 years old at the time when the proposal came and it was accepted, and she was 9 when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam consummated the marriage. This is the truth from which we cannot be shy. Now we have the hypocrites, and we have the orientalists, and we have the ones with sick minds and hearts, and we have the opponents and the enemies of Islam who use this to level accusations against the Messenger of Allah salawatu rabbi wa salamuhu alayh. They call him a pedophile. They say that he was a lustful man. All that he was worried about was fulfilling his physical desires, even with a little kid. May they be destroyed for saying those words. How do we respond? Because many will say, but what, you know, what can we say? This is what it was. You don't need to say much, but you need to understand a few things. Amongst them, as for the opponents of Islam and the enemies of Islam, then no matter what you do, if they have an agenda, then even if you do say she was 16, they will still find objection with that. He was 50 some odd, and she was only 16. What kind of a sick man was that? Wal'iyadu billah. It's hard to say these words about the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, what the people accuse him of being a pedophile and so on. But they said words about Allah. وَقَالُوا اتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ وَلَدًا سُبْحَانَهُ. People claim that Allah Jalla wa'ala had a child. That is a more severe accusation than accusing the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam of being a pedophile. It hurts me to say the words, but I have to tell it to you as it is. This is what they accuse him of. The next thing for you and I as Muslims, as believers, to understand is this. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was the best of all mankind. As a matter of fact, he was the best of all creation. The most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was chosen by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had he done anything wrong, Allah jalla wa ala would rebuke him and scold him for doing so. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had the highest moral character. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. It's not me who is testifying to that. It is Allah Jalla wa Ala from above the seven heavens. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. If you understand about whom we are speaking, How could you even for a fraction of a second say, wow, that was terrible? How could you for a fraction of a second think that what he did was inappropriate and unacceptable? Wallahi, you cannot. You cannot feel that it was inappropriate at all. Because it was coming from the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was guided by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lived in a place, and he lived in a time when this was normal. There was nothing wrong with it. Because the girls matured much more quickly at that time. Even in terms of their size and their stature, they were larger than us. And they lived out in the fresh air in the desert of Arabia where it was hot. They matured much more quickly. These are physical things that we know. And in those days, there was nothing wrong with some, it was accepted even culturally. For other things, people want to talk about historical context. Why here do we forget historical context? Look at the historical context. And I dare those people who want to speak against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in that way. Study your own history, whether it be in Europe or elsewhere. Over 1,400 years ago, were the cultural practices then the same as they are today? Well, like even here in Canada and the United States, if you go back not 1,000 years, if you go back 100 years, do you think that they were marrying as late then as they are today? No, because the people in those days, they would not refer to a 20-year-old as a child. Today our children are going to university at age 20. At age 20, they were fully matured and they were maybe, some of them might have even been grandparents at that age. They were married, they were running a home, and so people had taken on more responsibility. Certainly in this day and age, things are different. It is not accepted culturally, etc. Many of them don't mature until a later age. But the cutoff point for us, you know, it's not the cultural practices where we take our values and our morals from. We take them from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For us, and as a matter of fact, if you look into Christian and Jewish literature as well, you will find that over the ages, what was considered to be a suitable age for marriage was when that girl would reach puberty. And then it was normal for them to have reached puberty by the age of 9. So let's say for the sake of argument, we're not encouraging it in any way, shape or form, but let's say for the sake of argument, we hear that in the Muslim world, a 10-year-old who has reached the age of puberty and so on, was married to a man who is, you know, older than her, whatever, we shouldn't find anything wrong with that. Maybe you don't accept it because of where, you know what, we have been corrupted and our minds have been corrupted by outside sources and outside influences. We don't judge our religion. We do not judge our deen by what the outsiders have to say. What is true and is absolute, and it is found in the Qur'an and in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If he was a man who was only concerned about those things, I dare them, just look at his life. When he married his first wife, in the prime of his youth, he was 25 and she was 40. And he could have had any woman that he wanted. He came from a wonderful household, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he married a widow after that, Sauda radiallahu anha. And so, you look at the women that he married and you can see that this was not the case with him. You look at the way that he lived, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you will learn this is not, this is no pedophile and this is no lustful man. He was a man of honor and integrity and dignity, salawatu rabbi wa salamuhu alayhi. So may their mouths be filled with dust and dirt. Those who speak ill of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And those of us who may have entertained some doubts, let us repent to Allah Azza wa Jal for allowing our hearts and minds to go there after Allah Jalla wa Ala testified to him being of the highest moral character. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was actually shown Aisha radiallahu anha in his dream before he married her. Did you know that he said to her afterwards that for three nights, or two nights, I was shown in my dream. You were shown to me in my dream. An angel came to me with a piece of silk, and you were lying in it. And I was told to open up the face, to expose the face, and when I exposed the face, I saw you. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that time said that if this is from Allah, in other words, this dream is from Allah, then Allah will cause it to happen. And indeed it was from Allah. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married Aisha radiallahu anha wa ardaha. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. الحمد لله رب العالمين وعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. ثم صلوا وسلموا على خاتم النبيين وإمام المرسلين، فقد أمركم الله بذلك في كتابه المبين، فقال جل من قائل: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام: من صلى علي واحدة صلى الله عليه بها عشرا. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وأنعم على عبدك ورسولك محمد. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، وأذل الكفرة والمشركين، ودمر أعداء الدين. اللهم انصر المجاهدين في سبيلك في كل مكان. اللهم انصر المجاهدين في سبيلك في كل مكان. اللهم خذ بأيديهم وعجل بنصرهم يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. قوموا إلى صلاتكم رحمكم الله.
الله أكبر الله أكبر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح، قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر والله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح، ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا، فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفره إنه كان توابا. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. تبت يدا أبي لهب وتب ما أغنى عنه ماله وما كسب سيصلى نارا ذات لهب وامرأته حمالة الحطب في جيدها حبل من مسد. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.